Hi, Gene. It's good to talk to you again.
Great talking to you for a while.
You must be pretty happy about last week's decision, whereas I wouldn't say I'm in the dumps, I'm not exactly overjoyed about it.
But you were cited, and that's all that matters to us scholars, right?
Yeah, I was actually cited on both sides. I was cited by Stevens in his dissent, and somewhat, I think, perversely, by Scalia in a point arguing against Stevens.
Well, there you go.
So, for a historian, this is a big deal.
And I think one interesting thing about this case in general is that it shows that scholarship seems to matter. My sense is that even conservative justices some 20 or 30 years ago, before the spate of Second Amendment individual rights view scholarship, would have just dismissed the individual rights argument out of hand, much as Chief Justice Berger, definitely a conservative, at one point did. So this just goes to show that if people write law review articles and history articles, albeit ones that are also read by sympathetic justices, that can really affect things. Maybe affect things for the worse, but at least our sense that we are, occasional sense that just nothing we do matters, at least this case should put that to rest.
Well, do you think scholarship really matters, though, in terms of the outcomes? I mean, the outcome seems to have been fairly predictable. In terms of the basic voting alignments, so this is one of those cases this term which produced the conventional 5-4 split that some commentators have been saying had been disappearing from other decisions.
Well, I think you need two things. I think on the one hand you need justices who are open to the arguments and perhaps even sympathetic at some level with the arguments. But at the same time, you do need the arguments. My guess is that if you asked, say, in 1980, if you had asked Scalia, who had already been a law professor, was about to become a judge, if you'd asked Kennedy, if you'd asked Thomas and Roberts and Alito what they thought about the Second Amendment, they said, well, it secures the state's right to maintain their own militias, right? That was conventional wisdom at the time. As I said, even Chief Justice Berger took that view. My guess is that if it weren't for the spate of scholarship, they would have just been just as conservative on lots of issues. It's just that they would not have been open to the individual rights position here.
Yeah, well, I think that's a fair point. One of the things that troubles me about this, and it's something that my colleague Bob Spitzer has written about in a recent book, is that what passes for scholarship in the law reviews to a historian can be quite disturbing. One can make the argument that one of the things that's happened in the Second Amendment case is that precisely because law reviews are not peer-edited journals, a lot of things purport to be scholarship that really aren't, that would not pass muster. In other forms, but by
check out repetition. Check out some of the work by Michael Belil, and not just his Arming America book that was published in peer-edited journals, and you'll see how peer review can fail pretty badly, too. There are a lot of just downright unsound research.
Belil's book was not published in a peer-edited journal.
No, but some of his articles were published in peer-edited journals, and they were busted. They had lots of assertions that are just plain wrong. I actually use them as examples of poor source checking in a book I have in academic legal writing, as just how you can't trust secondary sources because they often just misstate things.
Right, that's true. Gene, one of the things that really interests me about this decision, and I wrote a quick op-ed about this for the Chicago Tribune the other day, is that it seems to me there are two versions of originalism that are being purveyed in the respective opinions for the majority by Justice Scalia and for the dissenters by Justice Stevens. And Justice Scalia's opinion, as I read it, and I'm just a historian and not a lawyer, so I may be missing some things, but as I read it, Justice Scalia comes down hard on the side of what's been called the public meaning version, or what I think he calls the normal meaning version of originalism. Justice Stevens does something a lot closer to the kind of work that I think I've done, which is much more grounded in the sources immediately surrounding the debates of 1787, 1788. And it seems to me that one could use the two opinions to organize a seven-hour conference or whatever, in which one of the big issues would be, will the real version or the superior version of originalism please stand up? As I'm sure you know, there are some aspects of Justice Scalia's opinion and this reliance on the so-called public meaning, which I find disturbing and problematic. And Justice Stevens seems to me to be the somewhat better historian in terms of trying to tie what was said specifically to the debates of 1787-88. But on the other hand, the more general question is, these are two alternative ways of getting at the original meaning. A lot of people have commented on this already, seem to suggest that each is a version of law office history, that each justice takes the form most conducive to the outcome that he wants to reach, and that wouldn't be very surprising if true. But it leaves me wondering, how are we to judge the comparative merits and demerits of these two very different approaches to the question of what a document originally meant? And what do you think about the public meaning argument?
Well, it's interesting you should raise this, because the history of the legal debate about this, in the, starting with the early 1980s, is quite telling here, I think. Ed Meese, Attorney General under Ronald Reagan, notably talked about original intent and urged the jurisprudence of original intent. If I recall, Judge Bork's arguments around that era also focused on original intent. And liberal scholars savaged the original intent argument for on various grounds, some of which I think are unsound, but one of which I think was quite sound, or a complex of grounds which I think is quite sound, said, look, this is a legal document. We shouldn't be trying to read the lawmakers' minds, among other things, because the people in Congress, let's say, in the Constitutional Convention, are only a small subset of the relevant lawmakers, which includes the ratifiers and others. On top of that, I believe there's some evidence that the framing generation itself did not see the unexpressed intention. Remember, the Constitutional Convention, not the First Congress, but the Constitutional Convention wasn't even supposed to have its debates recorded, or at least publicized. So they did not see the unexpressed intention of the drafters as particularly relevant. And the next generation originalism, coming out of generally the conservative camp, specifically said, look, there are some good points there, which is why we are now focusing more on original meaning and not on this original intent of what the authors happen to want to accomplish. Justice Scalia actually expressly threw his lot in with this, most prominently in as a matter of interpretation book. Randy Barnett, a noted libertarian constitutional scholar, has taken this view. My sense is if you look at the legal academy generally, both liberal and conservative originalists, but certainly conservative originalists, they will say, look, we're all original public meaning people. And not because of the particular outcome of the Second Amendment. This is a view that they had taken long before. So I think original public meaning, for many of the reasons that liberal critics of original intent had expressed in the 80s, is the right way of going. Because what it asks is, when you've got a legal document, which the Bill of Rights is, it's a law, it's part of the Constitution, what did it mean in the legal language of the era? What did it mean likely to the drafters? But if the drafters had a different view, it doesn't really much matter, because what did it mean to the ratifiers and to the people who were supposed to be governed by it? And that's, I think, Justice Scalia is quite right to adopt that approach. Now, maybe one might disagree with his sentiments of the original public meaning, although his sense of what it was, though I think that he's right. But I do think original public meaning is now the dominant view among both liberal and conservative originalists, and not just for the Second Amendment.
Well, see, this is quite interesting to me, because when I wrote my book, which I don't know whether you've read or not, on original meanings, as a historian's attempt to discuss and in some way solve problems of talk about original meaning, original intention, original understanding, I focused specifically on the debates of 87, 88. I've sometimes been wondering whether, in a certain sense, the whole rise of the so-called public meaning school has been a response to the brilliance of my own scholarship. I'll say that in certain kinds of chutzpahdict fashion, but that's to say I try to identify a number of uses but also a number of problems with trying to work with the actual materials from the constitutional debates of 87 and 88. And so I found myself speculating as I look at the rise of the so-called public meaning dictionary-oriented approach to originalism, whether I did such a good job that I drove the would-be originalist to have to come up with some other theory. Having said that, whether, you know, that's somewhat waggish, but who knows, somewhat waggish. Having said that, I have to say that there are a couple things that really disturb me about this. The first is the idea that one should characterize the Constitution simply or merely or primarily as a legal document. It's one thing to say it has to be interpreted as law, but it is, after all, a document which has a profoundly political character. It's framed by a bunch of guys who are acting as much as statesmen. And as lawyers, and it's ratified by a bunch of citizens who are acting as citizen delegates and not as legal authorities. So on that basis, it was seen to me, in terms of the opinions in Heller, that Justice Stevens, whose argument I think in some ways tracks the one that I wrote in my historian's brief, for this case, actually is much better grounded in terms of what people were actually thinking, saying, and doing at the time. And my real grievance, or I'd say my real complaint and concern and anxiety about Scalia's opinion and about the larger approach it takes, is what it really does is not to provide an original understanding of anything. It's a set of language games that contemporary legal scholars can can pull or in a sense try to manipulate by conjuring up a certain, a certain, or I'll say by imposing on the past a set of moves that are essentially being made in the present and then ascribed to people in the past, although, of course, it has to be documented in terms of some patterns of usage. So I think it's a really interesting methodological question about these two opinions. Which approach to getting at the original meaning of a document makes more sense? One that simply imagines there's a somehow typical disinterested citizen out there sitting there conscientiously with a bunch of dictionaries around him, reading the Constitution and trying to make sense of what's there, or there's an actual sense of political actors with specific motives, with specific concerns, who have conducted a specific debate, and the actual clause we're reading that we're trying to make sense of was the product not of that dictionary exercise, which is the construct of the modern lawyer, but of the political debate, which was the work of the framers and ratifiers in 1787, 1788. So when I read Scalia's opinion, and I see that it has almost nothing to say. I mean, there are a couple exceptions here because it's not totally ignored. But it has very little to say of substance about what was actually being debated in 87, 88, what was really on the agenda of constitutional statesmen at that moment. Instead, relies much more on 19th century commentaries or relies much more on this kind of generic mid-18th century definition, which I think is actually poorly documented in terms of demonstrating, stipulating how and why this is what Americans exactly believed. I think there are a lot of quick lawyer's moves going on here, which, far from being faithful to the original intent, are really highly manipulative of it.
Well, I do think there's a lot of manipulation going on, although I think it's in Justice Stevens' opinion. But I think Justice Scalia starts in exactly the right place, which isn't a dictionary. He starts with a text of the Second Amendment. And what he asks is what the text of both clauses and the relationship between the clauses likely meant to people who participated in that whole process. Historians talk a lot for very good reasons about what was likely in people's heads and the like. Lawyers generally are supposed to be interpreting legal text. And sometimes they can try to infer what was in people's heads, but they do it based on their sense of the words and how those words are used in contemporary sources, not just in dictionaries. The point of a dictionary is to try to capture what words actually meant at the time. So you do look at dictionaries, but you also look at other sources to see what the framers likely meant when they talked about, I shouldn't say the framers, what likely understood by the framing generation when the Second Amendment said, in the operative clause, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, for example. The right of the states? What is the right of the militia? Was it the right of people somehow as a collectivity or the right of people as individuals? When keep and bear arms was used, did it mean only to use them while in actual military service, which seems to be Stevens' position, although it's hard to pin down exactly what Stevens' position is, or did it mean keep in the sense of possess and bear, at least in certain instances, in the sense of carrying? So Scalia adduces, I think, very powerful evidence, not so much from dictionaries, but from contemporary legal sources that say, well, keep usually had a civilian meaning. Bear had mixed meanings, but often had a civilian meaning. He points to one source, he could have pointed to some others, which show that keeping and bearing were words that were used in this 18th century in gun control laws. When, for example, there were attempts to disarm the Scottish Highlands, the statutes talked about prohibition on keeping and bearing arms. They didn't mean prohibition on serving in the militia. That meant prohibition on having and carrying guns. So I think Scalia is very attentive to what the actual meaning of those words and phrases was at the time. Likewise with the militia clause. He does stress that it was a prefatory clause, and the operative clause spoke of the right of the people not being infringed, but he also describes what the likely meaning in 18th century language was of the language about militia, meaning the armed citizenry, pretty much.
Okay, Gene, but I think one problem with this approach, and especially thinking about this as a historian does, which means I'm particularly sensitive to issues of change over time, and everything that becomes dynamic and unstable and controverted in the course of the revolution, is militia is exactly one of those words which, precisely because of the revolutionary experience, is coming under a lot of stress. And it's perfectly clear, at least to me, from the debates of 1787, 1788, 1789, from the debates both at the Federal Convention and in the public sphere after the Constitution's published and has to be ratified, and even the debates in the first Federal Congress, which actually framed and proposed the Second Amendment, that the question of how the militia would be defined henceforth is exactly what was at issue. So to assume, as I think Scalia's opinion does, that there's a static, or to use his word, pre-existing definition of militia, which is somehow locked into usage, and in a sense is almost frozen and is resistant or almost immune to alteration or to change or to manipulation, that seems to me, as a historian who necessarily has to be sensitive to change over time, that seems to me to be an arbitrary, in some ways, ahistoric, fundamentally ahistorical assumption.
I think the one thing that we can say about the Bill of Rights, both about the original intentions and the original meaning on this, is on many things, you'd think that the two would go hand in hand, is that it was meant to set in hard-to-change writing, certain kinds of constraints on the government. Now, it's interesting. I did read your op-ed, which is very interesting, and it argued that while the Militia Act, say, of 1792 did continue the sense of militia being the entire armed adult citizenry who counted. Women and blacks, for example, were omitted.
Or men over 45.
Which was a much smaller group then than it is now. But that the Congress was understood as being empowered to narrow it further and such.
Right.
It's an interesting argument, but the trouble is, at least I don't see how it leaves the Second Amendment with any non-nullifiable meaning. Because if the argument is the right to the people to keep in their arms, the operative clause only applies to people while they're members of the militia, and if Congress was understood as being able to redefine militia any way it pleased, then this would be the one right in the Bill of Rights that Congress could, with a stroke of a pen, simply eliminate simply by defining the militia to mean only government employees, let's say. So, in fact, if anything, it seems to me that your argument of how militia would be variable and subject to control of Congress is one. If you're right on that, then there's just further evidence that the Second Amendment could not possibly have been intended to or meant as, or understood as meaning that the right of the people is only a right of those people who are members of the militia. Because that would be a nullifiable amendment. That would be an amendment that Congress could just dispense with. And that's a very odd way to read a part of the Bill of Rights. I should add that this is part of the broader problem of Justice Stevens.
Look, Gene, that presupposes that Congress, you know, has plenary authority over the militia. Now, Congress is given the authority to organize, arm, and discipline the militia, and you know, under Article 1, Section 8. And, of course, one of the main arguments in Scalia's opinion is that the militia already existed. The power to organize doesn't mean the power to create. One of the things that was specifically in dispute in 1787, 1788, and this is what Patrick Henry says and George Mason say in Virginia, where in some ways we had the fullest account, is that that Article 1, Section 8 power actually gives Congress the authority to effectively not only disarm the militia by not arming it, but really to disband it. And the standard Federalist response to that is to say that while Congress definitely has this overall supervisory authority, and we want to have uniform militia regulations to make the militia more effective, or we could say well-regulated or better regulated, that this is all, there is a kind of Tenth Amendment, latent premise here, which is the states retain their significant degree of authority over the militia as well. So that the existence of the militia is not wholly dependent upon congressional control. Congress has substantial authority, but it's a typical federalism problem of distributed authority between national and state governments. So Congress can do what it wants. The states still have a lot of residual authority, which in some ways I suppose the Tenth Amendment would also reinforce, to maintain the militia at a level adequate to their own perception of its needs. So in that sense, the idea that Congress is, it seems to me, that the, implicit in your response to my point, that Congress, that the danger, the amendment would be meaningless if Congress had that kind of sweeping authority, is in fact something that is itself disproved by the way in which the Federalists, the Anti-Federalists, debated this in 1787-88, and the members of the first Congress would have been acting on the basis of that political understanding. Now, that may be right or wrong, but let me come back to my larger point about Scalia. Scalia, in terms of his willingness or his obliviousness, a better way to put it, or his disdain for looking at the ratification debates, has no way to deal with that aspect of the debate. So he just writes those data points off the map. Or simply the way in which Congress, and I'm sure you know this from other things I've written or you've read, I think it's a really significant fact about the framing of the Second Amendment that the Senate deletes the key phrase militia, comma, composed of the body of the people, deletes composed of the body of the people. Now, as I'm sure you know, lots of individual right writers like Joyce Malcolm said, well, they did that in a fit of absence of mind or because it was a little bit redundant or they weren't paying enough attention. I actually think it makes much more sense to say they would have deleted that provision precisely because while reassuring the states that the militia will continue to exist, they did not want to lock the national government to a policy of saying the kind of militia we want to organize forever after has to be a militia composed of the whole body of the people. Because that would be too expensive and it would be ineffective.
Jack, so I want to pin you down, and I want to pin Justice Stevens down on what exactly they saw as the scope of the Second Amendment right. Jack, one second. Okay. Just let me highlight. At first, I thought in your response to my earlier question, you were going to say, oh, well, it's not within Congress's authority to redefine the militia. It's up to the states. But then you later turned to the state, back to Congress. And in fact, I was just looking in my papers for a copy of your op-ed. In your op-ed, you do talk about the framers meaning to allow future Congresses in their wisdom to replace this traditional militia. So as I understand it, it sounds to me like the militia was indeed something, in your view, not just the organized militia, but the entire militia, was something whose scope Congress had very broad authority to define, and to define, in fact, quite narrowly if it wanted to. But then it sounds to me like you're saying, oh, and though the rights is said to be the right of the people to keep and bear arms, it really was only the right of the people who are members of the militia to keep and bear arms. You put the two together, right that Congress could, as I said, nullify the stroke of a pen. But it sounds like you're saying, well, no, Congress couldn't nullify it, but then I don't understand. Either it couldn't nullify it because the right really does belong to the people rather than just to the militia, or it couldn't nullify it because the militia really was pretty close to the people, or at least most of them. But that's not the argument I heard you saying before.
Okay. So, Gene, I'm treating this, I think, as a matter of concurrent federal authority. I'm saying a national government concerned with making the militia an effective institution for national defense in Article 1, Section 8 is given the authority to organize, arm, and discipline the militia.
So far, I agree.
And the framers of the Second Amendment, some of the key members of whom, like somebody like Rufus King, or for that matter, James Madison, have been active participants in the convention debates, would not have wanted to restrict that authority of Congress to determine what an effective militia would look like in the future. But in doing that, they were not simultaneously abrogating the authority of the states to undertake additional measures to maintain a militia adequate to their own domestic needs.
The Second Amendment states, this
goes back actually to that law review piece you did, I forget where, but where one has to deal with the transition in American thinking about bills of rights from the kinds of declaratory statements you see in 1776 to the more prescriptive forms of stating a right that you see in 1789. I actually think that the Second Amendment is, and yeah, I've written about this in various places, as you know, the Second Amendment is the one member, it's the one clause of the Bill of Rights of 1789, which looks most like, sounds most like, one of those statements of principle of 1776. I don't think it was intended to state a broad-gauged individual right that would embrace the whole population.
But what right was it intended to state? What was intended to do as a legal document?
I think it's a legal document. It's not meant to do very much. I think it's a throwback to the statement of broad principles of Republican government of the kind that were much more common in 1776. It's meant to reaffirm the basic principle that a well-regulated militia is necessary to the security of a free state. That's a good thing. It's a useful alternative to standing armies. Let's say it's a preventive.
So when they say the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be abridged, what they mean is nothing. There is no right that is secure. Congress is restrained from abridging. It just doesn't mean anything, right? That's what you're saying.
I think it remains primarily a matter of state law. That's to say, the regulation of possession of firearms would be a matter of state law. Congress has authority to regulate the militia. The states are being reassured as a matter of principle that authority should not be used
to abrogate the militia or to destroy it.
Go ahead.
What congressional action? We know what congressional action the First Amendment prohibits. We know what congressional action the Fourth Amendment prohibits. We know what congressional action the Third Amendment, quartering of soldiers, prohibits. That is actually not very important, simply because Congress never really tries to do that these days. What congressional action does the Second Amendment prohibit that can be that can be understood as right. Therefore that prohibition secures a right of the people? Because it is right there. It does say right of the people.
Okay, I guess coming out of the debates of 87-88, the way in which I'd answer that question would be that when the ratifiers talk, actually to some extent I think the framers too, but when the ratifiers talk about the idea that the militia might be disarmed, the scenario that they explicitly address is not that of the Bureau of Arms, Tobacco, and Firearms, or whatever, it's Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, going door to door, not, looking to confiscate weapons. The scenario they discuss is that the militia will be disarmed simply because the national government will neglect it.
So the right of the people to keep and bear arms is a right not to be neglected by Congress. That's funny, because the First Amendment isn't a right to be free from neglect. The Fourth, Fifth, Sixth, Third, Seventh, Eighth Amendments are not a right to be free from neglect. But the Second Amendment, even though it talks about the right of the people, much like the Assembly Clause, the Fourth Amendment talks about right of the people, it's not really a right of the people not to be disarmed by government action. It's a right of the people, it's a weird positive right that Congress really ought to, although there's no judicial enforceability, neglect the militia.
Yeah. Look, all I'm saying is that when you read the debates, as a historian does, and try to ask the question, what were they really talking about? Whoops, just knocked the camera loose here. What was really at issue? What was under discussion? That's what was at issue. It wasn't anything about the private ownership of firearms. It wasn't anything about the BATF going door to door trying to confiscate weapons. It wasn't anything about whether or not the state governments would have legitimate needs and purposes to regulate access to firearms, regulate their use, and under a variety of police power pretensions.
That's a bit of a red herring.
All they were talking about in 1787-88 was the traditional argument that that it's better for a republic to rely upon a militia than a standing army, and keeping the people well armed, although how well armed would remain to be seen, would be a better alternative.
One of the things that come out
of the discussions of 1787-88. I think realistically, and this is actually where I think Michael Belial, for all his foolishness and fraud and incompetence, actually was on to an interesting question. I think there are a lot of assumptions in 87-88 and they turned out to be, by the way, correct over time, that the militia probably would wither away as an institution. There would cease to be an effective means of defense. Why? Because the frontier was going to recede. And Americans were not going to have widespread use for firearms. Though there wasn't much violent crime in 18th century America. Homicide was not a great problem in 18th century America. Americans were not really thinking about keeping firearms for purposes of private defense, because they weren't all that effective in that sense, and there wasn't that much crime to have to worry about. They weren't obsessed about it in the way they were, even the way they would become in the 19th century. There's some discussion in the 18th century, and it turns out to be right, that the militia, if it's not well regulated by Congress, it will in fact wither away as an effective institution. That's the context in which they are talking about these things. They were not talking about the right of self-defense. And they certainly weren't talking about the idea of whether or not you needed to affirm a right of self-defense well established in common law by centuries and centuries and centuries of jurisprudence and so on. They certainly weren't talking about the need to constitutionalize a right of self-defense within the Second Amendment. It wasn't on their, you can't say it wasn't on the radar screen, because they didn't have radar screens, but it wasn't on their intellectual horizon.
So you close your article, Jack, your op-ed, by saying, alas, there's no high court of historical review in which judicial statements about the evidence of history get to be challenged. And I do think that this is an interesting gulf that we're seeing in historians and lawyers, and lawyers are what the justices are supposed to be. So you talk about what was on the radar screen, what were their thinking, what they were trying to contemplate, but at bottom, for a lawyer and for a judge, the task is to figure out what the particular legal language means. And you've just basically told me, and unless I'm mistaken, that the language of the right of the people to keep and bear arms really doesn't secure any right of the people to keep and bear arms. Now, as it happens, of course, the English Bill of Rights did have a right to have arms with specific qualifiers that were omitted in the Second Amendment. And Blackstone talked about it as an individual right aimed in part at defensive purposes. Many contemporaneous state constitutions had various versions of a right of the people to keep and bear arms. Later generations, I realize maybe something vast happened between 1791 and St. George Tucker in 1803 and Story in 1833 and such, but you'd think that it wouldn't be that vast. They thought of it as a right of the people to keep and bear arms, but somehow, despite all this evidence that there is, that the Second Amendment really does secure a right of the people to keep and bear arms, based on what the framers thought, they didn't really mean to secure a right of the people to keep and bear arms. They only meant to try to encourage Congress not to neglect the militia. That's a very strange thing for a lawyer to accept.
It's a very strange thing for a lawyer to accept as a matter of
interpreting a legal document, which is what the court's job is to do.
Okay, but Gene, legal documents have their own kind of history. Bills of Rights have not had the same legal properties at all points in time, whether you go back to Magna Carta or 1689, the Declaration of Rights, or the kinds of statements of rights that were attached to colonial charters, or the kinds of statements of rights that were attached to the first state constitutions, the kind of Bill of Rights that was added to our federal constitution in 1787, 1789. There's not a one-size-fits-all model of what goes into a Bill of Rights. Bills of Rights have their own history. This is something I've written about at length, and in fact, I have a whole book on the subject. Consisting more of documents, and the argument of that book is the very definition of what goes into a Bill of Rights is itself something that changes. This is not a great mystery to a historian.
Okay.
Gene, it makes perfect sense to me to say in 1776 you could adopt a Bill of Rights that would use the monitory verb ought, and all the articles in it would be perceived not as legal commands enforceable in courts of law, but as general statements of principle by which everybody should abide, but would still leave legislatures open to violate them or to depart from them if exigencies require.
But that wasn't the view by 1789. By 1789, there was already the view of that, and in fact, there was an active structure of judicial review through the 1780s and 1790s in state supreme courts as well. So 1765, Blackstone.
You don't want to push that last point too far. The most interesting case in the last point would be, I think, the Massachusetts Declaration of Rights, which was made formally part of the Constitution, the state Constitution, as was Pennsylvania's, in a way that other state declarations were not. The use of the Massachusetts Declaration of Rights of 1780, Part 1 of the Massachusetts Constitution, to promote the cause of anti-slavery is a really interesting example. To promote emancipation in Massachusetts is an interesting example of how thinking of bills of rights as black letter law represents a move forward in legal thinking.
But there's a move that had already taken place by 1789. By 1789, the Bill of Rights was a binding legal document that secured rights of people. I don't hear any right of the people in what you're talking about.
I think in general I agree with that. I think to some extent it's still an arguable proposition, as I've written in some length in other places. It's interesting when you look at, for example, both James Madison and Melancton Smith, the federal farmer, when they write about the efficacy of a Bill of Rights, what they say it's going to be efficacious not because it's going to be legally enforced, but insofar as its principles are accepted either by the people collectively individuals.
Gene, let me finish my thought here. Sure.
All I'm saying about the Declaration of Rights is, I think in general the movement you describe is true, and I've written a lot about this point in my own scholarship, so obviously I'm not going to reject it or object to it. But I do think that the Second Amendment, curiously, is the most anachronistic or is the most throwback member. It's, as I said earlier, it's the one that sounds most like the statements of 1776 in terms of affirming a principle more than defining a kind of black letter right.
But it's a weird way of affirming a principle, right? The right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be
infringed.
Gene, you
keep quoting the text.
Ought might be different in some situations. I'm not sure that's right, but shall not be.
Right of the people, First Amendment, Fourth Amendment, right of the people shall not be.
It's funny that that's the only right that isn't actually a right in the Bill of Rights, in your view.
Well, it depends who the rights holder is. I mean, one way I like to talk about this is, you know, because, as you know, there's a big, the standard debate has been individual right versus collective right. What does the people mean is used here or there and in other places. You know, the very first time the people are given a right in the Constitution in general is in Article 1, where we're told the House of Representatives shall be elected by the people of the United States.
Oddly enough, it doesn't say the right of the people there. And whenever it says the right of the people, it's an individual right.
Gene, button it for a second. Let me finish my thought here. Okay, so in 18th century thinking, the right of representation, the most fundamental rights in 18th century thinking, constitutional rights, are the right of representation and the right to serve on a jury. In Article 1, Section 1 begins by saying the House of Representatives will be, you know, will be elected by the people of the United States, but the actual people vote will be determined, as we all know, and still the case today in some ways, as a matter of state law. So it's perfectly possible to have a definition of the people as the collective holders of a right, which still leaves ample room for restricting the positive exercise of that right to some subset of the people. In this case, it could be members of the militia.
So the right of the people in the Second Amendment, right next to the First Amendment's Assembly Clause and the Fourth Amendment's Search and Seizure Clause, the right of the people isn't actually the right of the whole people, it's the right of the militia. But, if I understand you correctly, the militia could be redefined by Congress to be pretty much as near as Congress wants to be. So the right of the people secured against Congress in the Second Amendment is the right of that subset of people that Congress wants to give the right to. And that is secured against Congress. Am I getting your position right?
In part, but, you know, I still think, and I say this mostly from going back over to the debates, particularly in Virginia, I do think there's an issue of concurrency here, because in Virginia, and remember Madison comes from Virginia, it's part of the Virginia Ratification Convention, the big debate, Patrick Henry's charge, I think supported by George Mason, had been that Article 1, Section 8 would give the national government plenary, comprehensive authority, sole authority, exclusive authority, to define what the militia was. And the Federalists, including Madison and also John Marshall, argue in response, essentially make a concurrency argument that it's going to be a shared authority, that giving Congress the authority to set general guidelines is not going to preempt any state action. The states are going to retain a strong residual power, a kind of, you know, think of a Tenth Amendment power or otherwise, to regulate militia. Certainly they can appoint officers. If they want to raise additional units, you know, they can still do that. So the question of how broad or how narrow the actual ownership or access to firearms would be would still remain substantially a matter of state law, not federal law.
Well, but wait. So first of all, you're now, I think, going back to an argument that was made earlier that this is a right of those people the state chooses to give a right to, which, again, is very strange. Within the Bill of Rights, when you talk about the right of the people, it's never states.
About the state.
But second, but no, isn't that what you said? The concurrency that your response to my argument, the militia, was, in your view, congressionally defined, I thought, was that it's partly state-defined. Am I misunderstanding you now?
It sounds to me like something nicely captured by the Tenth Amendment. The states have maintained militias for a long time. The states had obviously regulated access to firearms and use of firearms for a long time and will continue to do so under the 19th, 20th, and 21st century as well. Gene, let me shift this conversation a little bit.
I want to probe a little more of what you were saying there before we shift. I'm very happy to shift, by the way, because I think we may have kind of sucked this one dry. But you talk in your op-ed about that the framers meant to allow future Congresses, not Congresses plus states, but future Congresses in their wisdom to replace the militia. That's why I read your argument as being not that the right of the people is actually the right of those people whom the state wants to secure the right to, but rather I read your argument as being that the right of the people is the right of the militia. The militia can be replaced, can be redefined by Congress. Therefore, the right secured by the Second Amendment is a right only secured to those whom the federal government wants to give it to. That's how I understood your op-ed's claim that the militia could be replaced by Congresses in their wisdom, in the Congress's wisdom, and that at the same time, the right of the people is really only a right of the militia.
Okay, let me answer it this way, Gene, then I think we ought to drop this.
Sure.
So in everything I've read about the Second Amendment, it seems to be really consequential that when the Second Amendment is being drafted, it goes from the House of Representatives, as I said earlier, to the Senate, with the qualifying phrase, militia, composed of the body of the people. And if that phrase stayed in the stated in the document, I think the kind of argument for universal or, you know, or much broader access to firearms as a constitutionally entrenched right would be more persuasive. I think the deletion of that phrase by the Senate, which included members like Rufus King, who had spoken to this issue when the militia clause of Article 1, Section 8 was debated at the convention, I think the deletion of that phrase really was consequential, and it represented the desire of Federalists, both the Federalists who wrote the Constitution in 1787 and the Federalists who were writing the Bill of Rights in 1789, not to allow the need or the perceived need to assuage the concerns of anti-Federalists about the future of the militia. I think they wanted to assuage those feelings without compromising the capacity of Congress to exercise its Article 1, Section 8 powers as it wished. Including that phrase would really have restricted, as a matter of policy, Congress to forming a future militias, organizing, arming, and disciplining them on that basis.
But Jack,
I think the basic issue here, and this is where I'd like to put it back to you, is that the other thing that strikes me as incongruous about the discussion of 1787, 1788, is that I don't think anybody at the time, 89, you know, either at the Federal Convention or the ratification debates or drafting the Second Amendment, would have thought that anything the Federal Congress would do was going to trench upon, was going to restrict or limit or qualify the ability of the states under their police power jurisdiction to define how broadly or how narrowly access to firearms as a common law right, as a legal right, would henceforth be defined. Let me come back to the main question that I tried to raise originally. One of the things that strikes me as being really curious and problematic, not to say troubling, about the difference between the Scalia opinion on the one hand versus Justice Stevens' opinion, is that Scalia's opinion seems to me to be kind of wholly unrealistic or wholly naive or wholly wrongheaded in terms of reconstructing what the actual state of American federalism was in the late 1780s. That I think the framers of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights alike assumed the states would retain substantial police power jurisdiction over access to firearms, and nobody at the time would have understood or thought that adopting the Second Amendment would affect that jurisdiction one way or another. That's why neglecting those debates, the context within which the right to have firearms, to keep and bear firearms, or to have access to them was being debated. That's why it seems to me the treatment of that issue, the decontextualized treatment of that issue in Scalise's opinion, is really defective.
Jack, I think there's a very simple answer. Well, I shouldn't say very simple, but I think there is an answer to this question which I'd be happy to get to. But first let me say, the one thing that Congress didn't do with the proposal, the one thing they didn't delete was the right of the people. You say they may have deleted the militias composed of the body of the people. I actually agree that Congress could redefine at least the organized militia pretty much any way it wanted to. Mm-hmm. But the right is not a right of the militia. They could have said the right of the militia. They said the right of the people. So Congress might very well have very broad power to, as you quote, in its wisdom, to replace at least the organized militia. It's just that it can't deny the right of the people. Use that as a means of denying the right of the people to keep and bear arms. Now, as to your question about the states, I agree entirely that the Bill of Rights left intact the state's authority to control gun ownership, except in the narrow sense that if Congress demanded that, for example, certain members of the militia be armed, it could preempt that in certain situations for its own purposes. But nothing whatsoever in Justice Scalia's opinion denies that. Justice, he would clearly agree that the First and the Fourth Amendments, as enacted in 1789, as the ratification 1791, would have left states with very broad authority, in fact, authority unlimited by the federal constitution, to restrict speech and provide for searches and seizures and so on and so forth. The question of what state authority is there is an important question, which will be raised in the next case, which asks whether the Second Amendment was incorporated through the 14th Amendment in 1868. But I don't see how you could fault Scalia for missing the evidence that the framers didn't intend to displace state and local gun regulations. Scalia never says anything about the framers intending to displace state and local gun regulations. In fact, he specifically reaffirms Barron v. Baltimore, which, of course, everybody does, which made clear that the Bill of Rights was indeed intended to only constrain the federal government. And as it happens, this particular law was a law enacted by a federal jurisdiction. The court had no occasion to decide the extent to which states are constrained, though the states would clearly be constrained not by the Second Amendment, but by the 14th Amendment. Maybe I'm misunderstanding your question, but I don't really see how you can fault Scalia.
Okay, let me try to straight it, I think the same point, but a slightly different way. what incentive, what rationale, what imperative, what need would there have been in 1789 to constitutionalize at the national level a right of personal self-defense, which it seems to me is very much part of Scalia's opinion. But if I'm wrong on that, correct me. But what if you're a historian looking at what's actually under debate in 1787, 1788, 89, and you ask the question, who's discussing as a matter of national constitutional principle, a personal right of self-defense? There's virtually nothing that I know of that anybody has ever cited that qualifies under the heading, with the possible exception, well, with the exceptions of the statements from the Pennsylvania dissenters, Pennsylvania Convention about the right of the people to keep and bear arms for their own and for their own defense and that of the state. Now, one of the things I argued in my brief, this may get us off on a tangent longer than we can exhaust, is there's some reason to think that in Pennsylvania, even when that language of their own defense is used, the point was not an individual right of self-defense. It really had to do with the fact that the whole tangled history of the militia, or the lack of a militia, in late colonial, pre-revolutionary Pennsylvania, where a Quaker-dominated assembly had simply refused to extend an organized militia to frontier counties, which badly needed it, so that even where you find the language of defense being used, it was still about the defense of the community and not the defense of individuals. More generally, I mean, there is some discussion of this in Scalia's opinion, so I have to be careful here, but it remains highly improbable and implausible that the framers of the Second Amendment would have had a strong incentive, or really any imperative need, to affirm a personal right of self-defense in the form being expressed in this case, in this opinion, at the federal constitutional level, when that established common law and something, again, regulated by the states. I think this gets at the same issue that my prior question was getting at, which is how does the Second Amendment relate to personal self-defense at all? Why would that have been an issue in 1789?
Well, as I understand
it, as a constitutional matter.
So there were 12, of course, amendments in the Bill of Rights. The first two were voted down at the time. The remaining 10, I believe, got unanimous support. They were included because they were uncontroversial.
No, actually, they didn't get unanimous support.
Pardon?
I think a couple states only ratified some parts of the 20th century.
I just looked it up for separate reasons recently, and I think it is unanimous support. These were not terribly controversial matters. What's more, they were generally, not entirely.
They weren't terribly important either. But.
They were generally seen as restatements precisely of what was long understood to be the rights of Englishmen. Incidentally, I should say that as the state constitutions, I think is very solid evidence that that the Pennsylvania provision actually was aimed at personal self-defense. Certainly Pennsylvania courts have interpreted this way. I'm looking at actually a site in the Heller majority, which is quoting from Justice James Wilson. Who was a Pennsylvanian who was also participating in the drafting of the 1790 provision. So in any event, there was a well-established right to keep and bear arms. I shouldn't say keep and bear arms. The right at the time was said to be the right to have arms. That was the English Bill of Rights language for among other things, defense purposes. That was a right that when they added to the Bill of Rights, they understood it would be uncontroversial precisely because it was long understood to be a right of Englishmen. Now,
why would that right need to be federalized in 1789?
Why does the right be free?
Why does the right of personal self-defense need to be?
Why does the right to be free from federal
in 1789?
Why was the right to be free from federal takings without compensation need to be constitutionalized? Why does the why did the right, for example, even to be free from or to have a I'm sorry, the compulsory process for getting witnesses in one's own defense. Not because they were somehow controversial, not because in 1788 there was a dramatic controversy about the taking of private property or about confrontation of witnesses, but because once you start out drafting a Bill of Rights, once you look at all these proposals, after all, much of the Bill of Rights was animated by proposal by ratifying conventions for them, once you start coming up with this list in a way that you're hoping would be uncontroversial, you include those rights that you think Americans see as basic rights of Englishmen and now of Americans. Very few of those rights, I think, were responding to specific controversies that had just arisen, that there was a pressing need to respond to. They were there because they were included by Madison, who originally, of course, thought Bill of Rights wouldn't be that necessary, because a lot of people in ratifying conventions thought that they would be good to have. And Madison wanted to retain public confidence in this new constitution, and incidentally, to get reelected in the future. So there goes the Bill of Rights, including a provision proposed by his very own Virginians.
Yeah, but nobody in the state ratification conventions talks about a personal right to self-defense.
Well, it talks about the right to keep and bear arms.
But against the
backdrop of Blackstone, the one thing we know about the time is people read Blackstone. People understood their rights as Englishmen. One of the rights was the right to have arms, including for self-defense. Blackstone makes that quite clear.
But if you read Blackstone, you also get a strong statement of legislative supremacy consistent with the parliamentary doctrine of 1689, which says that the actual exercise of those rights, and this is standard 18th century rights talk, is always subject to a whole array of reasonable restrictions, and certainly of which, for example, the game laws in England would be one. Now, I'm perfectly happy to concede that Americans on the whole were proud that they had nothing like game laws of the kind being enforced in 18th century England, and they saw that as a point of contrast between the superior practice of rights in their society and the practice of rights in the mother country. But again, I don't see any imperative in 1789. Put it another way, that I know they were really concerned about the future of the militia because there's ample documentation for that. The idea that they were concerned about a personal right for self-defense is very hard to corroborate.
But, Jack,
In terms of what people actually said and discussed, and again, this is just, you know, historians trying to, you know, set the text within the context.
Even the First Amendment was actually very lightly debated within Congress. Congress didn't spend much time on the Bill of Rights. So the fact that they didn't talk that much about the details of what the Second Amendment right was going to secure isn't that surprising. Nor, as I said, should we be asking, I think, why it is that there was this pressing need. As I said, I don't know of any pressing need as to the Takings Clause. The sense is when you're creating a Bill of Rights to constrain the government, you just look to see what the rights you cherish are, and you try to secure them as much as possible. As to your points about Blackstone, first of all, of course Blackstone was writing against the backdrop of legislative supremacy. Equally clearly, the Constitution, that was one thing the Constitution was changing. The Constitution was constitutionalizing, that is to say in the American sense, certain rights that the British Constitution left subject to the control of Parliament. So yes, naturally, the framers understood all of the rights in the Bill of Rights as not just being Blackstonian, subject to the control of Parliament. But if you're looking for what the content of what they were, I think looking to the English backdrop is an important step, as the Supreme Court had repeatedly said in the course of interpreting the Bill of Rights. As to reasonable regulations, I should say I agree with you entirely. At least that reasonable regulations would be allowed. We may have disagreement about what's reasonable, but the framers did not see any of the rights, certainly not free speech, as being absolute. They certainly recognized that there would be reasonable regulations allowed on a wide range of rights. My point is simply when they said the right of the people to keep and bear arms, they meant that the people had a right to keep and bear arms subject to reasonable regulation as opposed to subject to nullification by Congress whenever Congress wanted to constrain the militia. I thought when we were saying that we should move on, we would move on a lot further, because I do think there's some very interesting historical questions and practical questions here about, for example, 1868 and whether the 14th Amendment should be read as incorporating the Second Amendment. That will be the next case the Supreme Court will have to decide this. Also, if you're inclined, I'd be happy to talk to you about what the decision might mean for modern gun controls, although perhaps that's not something you'd be interested in.
This is where historians get to use their favorite disclaimer. Sorry, but that's after my period.
There you go.
It's
not history, it's journalism.
And the present. I think when the court rules on the next case, that'll be time enough for us to have a rerun of this. I think the last thing I'll say, because we should probably wrap it up about now anyhow, is that I think the next round of cases will be interesting cases precisely on the grounds that I think I was just trying to suggest, namely that I don't think anyone in the 18th century, or I think for that matter the 19th century, would have thought that the federal constitution, whether it's the Second Amendment or the 14th Amendment, should be used to constrain a state government's police power capacity to regulate use of firearms and access to firearms under that traditional conception of its responsibility to act for the health, well-being, safety of its population. Now, I want to be careful here because when you get to the 1860s and you look at, you know, I guess looking ahead to the Cruikshank case of the 1870s and the way in which in the South the lack of access or deprivation of access to firearms had a profoundly adverse impact on the population of freedmen, there you get a whole political dimension to the firearms question, which I think was probably missing earlier. But I think it's one of the things that I think I've been disappointed with. I tried to put it into our brief, but we didn't have that much on it. I think this whole police power question, how the police power was construed in the 18th and 19th century, has been a strangely neglected aspect of Second Amendment constitutional discourse. And I think once the next round of cases arises and the question of how much can states go? How far can states go when the right now has been individualized? Even so, to have prudential police power grounds for restricting access to firearms, this will be a really interesting set of questions. Hopefully, it'll lead for some fresh debates instead of the tired ones that you and I have just been rehearsing.
I agree. I do think there's a lot to debate about in the incorporation context. My sense is that both liberal and conservative scholars in recent years have generally taken the view that the 14th Amendment was understood as, in fact, applying to the states, incorporating against the states, pretty much all of the first eight amendments of the Bill of Rights, with a possible exception of the Establishment Clause. Well, there will certainly be a big debate about that. My understanding also is during the 14th Amendment debates, actually the right to bear arms was one of the rights that the backers of the 14th Amendment most often cited as a right that the 14th Amendment was intended to secure against the states, because that was a point of the 14th Amendment. I agree entirely that it left a considerable residuum of power to the states, to the police power to the states, as to the First Amendment as well as the Second Amendment. But the power to regulate in the interest of health and safety did not include, I think, for example, the power to ban all guns, or even, I think, to ban all handguns.
Yeah,
but
so
you're
right,
that would be the subject of the next case.
We have to say that a lot changed in the 19th century, and it was in the 18th.
I think
that would be my last point here.
I'm happy to say that things change.
Yeah.
And they'll keep
Tout
going.
Pour le même chose. Anyhow, great. Thanks a lot.
Great talking to you, Jack.
You know, see you some other time.
Absolutely.